Welcome to worship. It's a wonderful opportunity on a cold winter morning to gather and turn our hearts and minds towards the words of the psalmist. The psalmist can always be counted on giving us beautiful images, beautiful ways of understanding and even gathering a vision of God. And this morning when we turn to Psalm 36, we're blessed. We're blessed with these beautiful images of not only God's love, but how God provides refuge for all people. Using the cosmic images of God's love extending into the heavens and God's love flowing like a fountain that offers life and salvation. We're welcomed into a place where we often are not found to be visiting, the holy place, a place that the psalmist creates for us, and maybe prayerfully hoping that we would create some place like that for ourselves within our hearts, or maybe even within our capacity as humans with the abundance that God has blessed us with. And so this morning we reflect on Psalm 36 and how it provides refuge for us and encourages us to be the constructors of refuge for others. Welcome to worship.
Okay, please join me in reading responsively this morning's call to worship. Your love, O God, extends to the heavens, and your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your judgments are like the great deep. You save humans and animals alike, O God. How precious is your steadfast love, O Lord. Your people find refuge in the shadow of your wings. Blessed are all who feast on your abundant love. All praise and thanks to you, O Lord. May our hour of worship glorify your holy name.
Thank you. Now let's join together in the opening prayer. Extravagant God, we gather in the sacred places we call home. We humbly pray you will stretch over us under your canopy of grace. Shelter us, O Lord, in the protection of your love, so we may delight in your holy presence. Shape and mold us for your will to be done. Create in us generous hearts and compassionate minds. Amen. And now the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, Mother God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The scripture reading today is from Psalm 36, verses 5 to 10. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your judgments are like the great deep. You save humans and animals alike, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. All people may take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light, we see light. Oh, continue your steadfast love to those who know you, and your salvation to the upright of heart. God is still speaking.
Good morning again, church, and welcome to worship to all those who have joined our Zoom worship since the beginning and those that came a little bit later. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to take a moment, of Sabbath, to rest in the comfort of our homes, to rest in the refuge that you extend to us, the comfort of your love, the security of your compassion, and the hope that you give us through the mercy and the loving acts that we experience through others who set a table for us, not one which we may sit at, but a table of human hospitality, a table that welcomes us into relationship and extends to us the promise. The promise that you are always with us and that your love is everlasting and without condition. May our time together in reflection enable us to imagine and to take these images of the psalmist as building blocks for our own efforts to be the church. The church abundant, the church of compassion and hospitality and mercy, the church that sets the table for all of your people. And so may the meditations of our hearts, the wanderings of our minds, find ways to be pleasing and acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The parsonage that my family and I lived in East Hartford for 10 years was in the heart of the neighborhood, the Burnside neighborhood it was called, it still is. And the parsonage was surrounded by apartment buildings and multi-unit housing. two, three family apartments, as well as the apartment blocks made up the surroundings of the church and the parsonage. It's a very densely populated and busy neighborhood, and it had two bus stops. One bus stop was right in front of the parsonage, right at the end of the driveway. The parsonage abutted the church property, and so the passengers would walk through the parking lot of the church and through the lawn from the apartment buildings and find their way to the corner of the driveway, where they would wait as both students and workers for the bus to come and take them to their destination. The bus stop was not only at the end of the driveway, but it was right in plain view of the window of my study, which was connected to the kitchen. So I would often see people coming and going and waiting for their transportation. This particular bus stop, though, unlike the other, had no shelter. It was wide open. And for some reason, the shelter on the main street, avenue, had a shelter on both sides. May have been because it was a state highway, I don't know. But what I do know is that my attempts to convince the powers that be at town hall to construct a shelter on the church property were not heard and went unattended to. And so people, no matter what the weather would be standing on the corner, waiting for their bus to come. One morning, it was raining very hard. It must have been early in the spring. And I was concerned that folks out on the bus stop were going to get very wet and cold before the bus arrived. So I went out and invited folks to come and stand on the porch of the parsonage, which was in plain view of the bus stop. They could see the bus coming down the street so they could get out to the stop in time, but at least they would be sheltered. It was a little porch that extended off the kitchen and off the study, so it was easy for folks to stand on, and it was easy for me to see and welcome folks into God's presence through the hospitality of the parsonage. I remember one morning going into my study and seeing the back of one passenger. And she was a student waiting to take the bus to the local high school. I was surprised by her presence because she didn't wait for an invitation, which was fine with me. She just found her refuge on her own. And there she waited quietly for the bus to arrive. And on repeated occasions, she would find her way out of the weather, standing on the porch of the parsonage. I introduced myself and welcomed her and wanted to make sure that she felt welcomed, even though she took the invitation on her own. I never got to really know her well. I think she moved out of the area, but I didn't get to see her as often as I hoped because I really did want to get to know her. And there were two goats. These goats were not in East Hartford, Connecticut. They were not at the bus stop. These were two goats, one living in Ghana, one living in Paraguay. There's stories that go with these two goats, and this goat in Paraguay was a goat who found refuge in an outhouse. It was a place where I was living temporarily, a small, I don't know what you would call it, very informal Airbnb, but there wasn't Airbnb back in that time, but it was a place where I was taking up temporary refuge. And it was here this goat would find his refuge every evening in the particular place where you would not want him to be, the outhouse. So if one had to use the outhouse, you would have to convince the goat that he'd have to give up his temporary refuge. Another goat that I came across in Ghana was one who would run into the church. It was the rainy season when I was there this particular time, and the goat lived nearby. Its family let it run loose, But every time it would rain around midday, this goat would scamper up the stairs of this church and find its way into the stairwell. And there it would wait for the rains to subside. Both of these goats, just like us, knew where to find refuge, where to get out of the elements. And all of us have our own stories of finding refuge, of finding a place to get out from a downpour, finding a place to take up some shade in the bright summer sun. Maybe it was under a tree, maybe it was in the doorway of a building, maybe it was in a neighbor's waiting car. But we're all familiar with the relief and the joy and the comfort that comes with finding refuge from the elements of weather or life that cause us to feel the need to be covered, to be embraced, to be protected, to be dry, to be cool. Some of us even know and have experienced seeking refuge in more extreme conditions. Refuge that is much more about than escaping the inconveniences of weather. Refuge that is needed from the struggles and the violence of war. Refuge that is needed and sought when one is in the midst of domestic violence. Refuge which is required and necessary for when you're unsheltered and struggling with homelessness. Refuge when one is a migrant, traveling through foreign lands and no place to call home. And then, of course, refuge from natural disasters, whether it's a flood or a fire, or tornado or a hurricane, finding a safe place to be, a place to call home temporarily, but to please feel secure in refuge. The Judean Christian story is a refuge-seeking story. You can go through the Bible and find these wonderful stories and themes of humans seeking a place to be. The Hebrew stories of Exodus and exile are the most familiar refuge stories that we may know. They're stories of our faith ancestors who were wandering, trying to find their way to the promised land, or they were waiting in a foreign land in temporary refuge, hoping that soon God would lead them and free them to return to their permanent refuge, the place they called home. In the New Testament, in the Gospel, there are stories of disciples and Jesus himself seeking refuge. Jesus sent his disciples, his apostles, out two by two, not with a place to go, but a place to be. To be those who would find refuge in the hospitality of those who are willing to hear the story of God's saving love, as proclaimed by Jesus. Jesus himself would wander about from place to place and oftentimes invite himself into some friend's homes where he would be provided refuge. You can think of the story of Mary and Martha and Lazarus. You can think of all the stories of Jesus arriving and having a meal or teaching or offering healing. Jesus, a wanderer seeking refuge, not only in places that could offer hospitality, but in the embrace of God. Refuge when he would take off and go off to be alone in prayer, when he would go to a mountaintop. Spiritual refuge, a place where he could connect to God and feel God's ever-present and everlasting love. Let's go back to Psalm 36, verses 7 and 8 for this morning, and imagine these beautiful image created by the psalmist. The psalmist creates this image of God created refuge. a place for God's people to be. Not a structure, but a spiritual location, a spiritual place. And the psalmist says this place is for all people. Not for a particular group or constituency or community. It was for all people. In the mind of the psalmist, God's refuge was for anyone and everyone who needed it. A place created by and out of the precious, steadfast love of God. These are the words of the psalmist. Precious, steadfast love of God. A place created in the shadow of God's wings, says the psalmist. Another beautiful image. If you've been around any kind of farm animals and you've noticed how they provide care for their young, and particularly the chicken, the hen who would extend her wings out wide so all the young chicks could huddle underneath to be warm and out of the elements and to feel secure. The psalmist understood how this image of the bird, the large winged bird, could offer refuge and love and safety to its youngs. Refuge is a holy place, a place, again, where all of God's people can not only be sheltered from the elements of life, but also a place where one can feast upon God's abundant offering. And also, the psalmist gives us this beautiful image of drinking from God's river of delight. For a refuge offered by God is for life and light. For life and light. These elements of life itself. Water, light. All of what God offers to us through the power of God's love. I personally applaud Mayor Michelle Wu's work. Over the past few weeks, early in her administration, she has worked very hard to provide refuge to the homeless that have been living for an extended, very long period of time in the Mass and Cass neighborhood. Many of the neighbors are living, they had been living and continue to live with the struggles of substance abuse disorder and mental health challenges. And without wasting much time, she and her administration started finding places where refuge could be offered, various locations through the city, locations where transitional housing could be provided immediately while permanent housing was located. I believe Mayor Wu believes there's more than enough abundance and wealth in the city of Boston to extend shelter and health care to all who need it. I believe that she understands that no one should be living unsheltered or unfed. For me, her work is a reflection of what the psalmist is preaching and teaching us this morning about God's steadfast love. That is for all of God's people. That all of us, all of God's people, are entitled to have their basic human needs met. That is refuge. And Mayor Wu is doing her best to make sure that no one in the city goes without those basic human needs. And this is the message of the psalmist. God's love is materialized by abundant and life-giving acts, both public and private. The message from the psalmist, the message that she is teaching us this morning, is that we are a people of God who both receive the benefits of being the people of God who are blessed with the opportunity to share and materialize God's abundant love. in both public and private ways. As a church who has always advocated for the homeless, there are churches that have turned their buildings into shelters very close by. There are church leaders and people who have done everything possible to make it clear to our public leaders, to our legislators, that laws must be changed and funds appropriated to increase the amount of affordable housing, to make sure shelters are open, to make sure no one suffers from the cold, the heat, and especially from being unsheltered. And when I reflected on Psalm 36, I really came to understand that it speaks to us as God's people, but also speaks to us very specifically as a congregation. And you have probably heard this theme from me in many different ways and more than once. But it is a theme and a reality that God has placed before us, and we must stay with this theme of hospitality, this theme of abundance, this theme of setting a table, this theme of being God's people in this place and time. And we must stay with this theme or these themes until God guides us over the finish line. For this congregation has been called to be a church of abundance, a church that's able to offer refuge. Refuge in all the facets of its meaning. We are called to be God's people, a faithful church that sees how God's light shines upon us for the purpose of setting a table for all of God's people. A table where God's people can feast and drink upon the delights of God, the food for the fullness of life. Well, you may be thinking, well, what kind of table is the pastor talking about? Is it a long table that has many plates and many cups and many forks and spoons? Is it a table that we would set up to serve food? Well, yes, that's obviously a table that the church has been setting for years, offering food for the hungry. But there's another table that needs to be set, a table that provides spiritual food, a table that is blessed with the abundance of God's love, a table that is established for all people, as the psalmist says, to come and drink deeply from the rivers of God's delight. It's a table that is really about the provisions of love and mercy and forgiveness. It's a table that we have been called to set, and all churches are always called to set. It's a table where God's people can feast and drink upon the delights of God, the food again for the fullness of life. And that's where we are at. We're at this place of abundance where we, as God's people, this congregation, can think about, what does it mean to set this table? What does it mean to be a place where God's people can come and enjoy the gifts of God for the fullness of life? This afternoon, between 1 and 3, we as God's people have the opportunity to be the church abundant. We have the opportunity to come together between 1 and 3 on Zoom to put our minds and hearts to work on imagining a place of refuge, on imagining a life-giving ministry, and how that fits in to the space and the place that God has blessed us with. This afternoon, between 1 and 3, we'll be in holy conversation. It's not a business meeting. It's a holy conversation, and it's both personal and collective. We will speak from our hearts, and we'll speak as a community, for it is our personal and collective responsibility to be stewards of God's wealth while being disciples of Jesus Christ. How do we set the table? How do we live out being the church abundant, the church that has been so blessed by God's love? And so, this is the ministry. This is the ministry that God has laid before us, to be the stewards of God's wealth, to be disciples of Jesus Christ, and, of course, to be the people who are not afraid to extend the steadfast love of God as the wings of God, to extend the steadfast love of God for years to come, to be the fountain flowing with water from God's river of delight, the waters of life, healing, recovery, and wholeness that flows from the connection and community. These are the images that the psalmist gives us to work with. Refuge, rivers, all sources where one can discover the profound and powerful and unconditional love of God. Friends, this work that God has set before us is going forward. God has set us on a path, and leaders and new members and friends have provided the momentum. And now is the time for us to focus the eyes of our hearts on what does it truly mean for us to create this new place, this new refuge. God has not brought us this far for us to stop or to turn around. The path before us has already been established. God already knows where we're going. The question that God has for us is, what do we see? What do we see in the light of God that shines upon us? What is the path that God's light is shining upon us? How can we discern through prayer and conversation where God is leading us? And how do we see the future of holy refuge dedicated to worship, service, hospitality, and of course, the unimaginable? How do we see it? And so our conversation is much more than figuring out square footage, and that's really not our job. Our job is to listen to one another, to listen to God, and to keep these images of refuge and life-giving water and the broad wings of God in mind. Because that is truly the ministry of Jesus Christ. To extend God's love through whatever image that you may find into matters and ministries of hospitality and service. I hope that many of you that are listening this morning will take time this afternoon between 1 and 3 on Zoom. And if you don't have the link, we can provide it to you, even put it into the chat. I hope you'll be there. I hope you can join this holy conversation. And I hope you will come and even find refuge in the joy of being the church abundant in holy conversation. I hope you'll find joy, even though we can't be together, in conversation with your brothers and sisters that are committed to setting a table for all of God's people. This is so important. And this is why I repeat it over and over again. Because God has given us this opportunity, and Scripture keeps bringing it forward to remind us that this is the way of the church. This is the way of God to be the constructors, to be the co-creators, to be the imaginative builders of the kingdom of God here in this place and time. People we know and people we don't know are seeking refuge from the elements of the weather, but also seeking refuge from the struggles of life, from the weight of the pandemic, from being alone, jobless, hopeless. There are people we know and people that we don't know who are struggling with the realities of life as it is today. And there are people we know, and there are people that we don't know that are thirsty and looking for a place where they can go and drink deeply from the river of God's delights. And maybe even call it home, spiritual or otherwise. There are people we know and don't know who are really wondering as they look at a church building, whether it's Belmont, Watertown, United Methodist Church, or any church building, they're wondering if God's love is steadfast and real. And they truly aren't convinced if they cross the threshold into the sanctuary, the refuge, that they will experience it. We, the Church Abundant, need to be a place that is wide open and welcoming, but also clearly expresses God's love when one crosses the threshold, a place where God's love can be discovered, rediscovered, shared, and used as a way of living. Friends, this is our ministry. This is our ministry. The revitalization of the ministry of Jesus Christ in this community and the community of Watertown. This is our ministry. It's the ministry of coming together in conversation. It's the mission to use God's resources, abundant resources, for God's purpose. This is our ministry and mission. It is to create refuge, not only for ourselves, but for all of God's people, as the psalmist keeps reminding us. We do not do it for ourselves, but for all of God's people, our lives included. We're doing it for this, those who are waiting and wondering, how can they fit in? How can they be part of this great enterprise of God's love and salvation? They're waiting and wondering if the love of God is steadfast and if God has something for them to do as well, to share in the wonderful work that God has set before us. God has called us to be God's wings of refuge and to share God's steadfast love in this place and this time. This is our mission. This is our ministry. For we are the Baptist community. We have already said yes. And God is delighted with our response. Now we have the opportunity, the Church Abundant, to keep pushing forward on the path that God has established, where God is waiting for us to meet up with God in the glorious place where refuge has been created and the delights of God to be shared. May we all pray that the light of Epiphany, the vision of God's future, the vision of Christ leading God's people into a new place and a new time and a new creation. May the light of Epiphany shine bright upon our path, upon our holy conversation. May the light of Epiphany cast God's vision clearly before us so that we keep moving forward, not stalled or stuck and wondering if God is with us. For God is Emmanuel. May God's vision be wide and deep. May God's vision be our way. Amen. We pray, O Lord, that your steadfast love will guide us in our conversation with you as we fully open our hearts to you, knowing that no matter what, your love pours forth like the river of your delights. We know, O God, from the words and the images of the psalmist that your love extends to the heavens and your faithfulness to the clouds. We know, O God, that your righteousness, your justice is like the mighty mountains in the great deep sea. and that from this love flows your desire to save humans and animals alike. Oh, how precious, O God, is your love. And as always, we pray for those that we have named and those that go unnamed, that your love manifested through acts of healing, through the presence of companions, through the love of family, through the practice of charity and mercy, that your love will touch the hearts and the lives of those people that we have named before you. We pray, O Lord, that those that are in transition from this life to the next, or those that are suffering with a chronic disease or living through COVID, will somehow feel the comfort and the protection of the shadow of your wings. And for those that are hungry, O Lord, looking for their daily bread or looking for the spiritual food or drink that will enable them to rise up hopeful in the next day, we pray, O Lord, for that feast, that it be set before them through the compassion of neighbors and friends and through the work of the church and all people of faith. We pray, O Lord, for those that are traveling, that their journeys would be safe, that they make acquaintances along the way that may provide an opportunity to extend a message of your love. We pray, O Lord, as we travel from place to place, that we always believe that upon our destination, there your refuge will be found. Oh, you never leave our sides. We pray, O Lord, and give thanks for the ministry of this church, the abundance that we have, and the possibilities and opportunities that you lay before us. We ask you, O God, to accompany us this afternoon, to let your spirit be within our hearts and minds, in our conversation, that they be holy and not only fruitful for our purposes in getting things done, but fruitful for discovering and recommitting to your will, that it be done here in this place and this time as in heaven. Gracious and loving God, be with us this week as we continue to wander through these uncertain times, and help us to find ways to be in service to others and to love our neighbors and to do what is pleasing and acceptable in your sight. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. I invite you to join me in this prayer of dedication and thanksgiving. As I always say, during the course of the week, we have received many blessings. We have received in the mail blessings of tithes and offerings. We have received the blessings of being the church in so many different ways. And so we pray this prayer of thanksgiving and dedication, acknowledging the provisions and steadfast presence of God. Let us pray. Lord, blessed are we to share the banquet of your goodness here at home and beyond. You call for our thankful response for your holy generosity. Having feasted upon your abundance, we offer ourselves and our resources. May our gifts help to share the wealth of your creation and the promise of new life. Amen. Now, Joel, is this something we can do this Sunday by putting up on the screen the gallery view, or is this still not possible? Let's give it a try so that we can see one another. I can't see everyone, but you can see everyone. And just extend a sigh of Christ's peace to one another, a smile, an offer of peaceful refuge from one home to another. The peace of Christ be with you today and always. Amen. Again, please join in the conversation about our property revitalization and redevelopment today. You can see on the screen also the link that will be made available and has been sent out through Realm. So please, if you can, be present for this important holy conversation. Today is Human Relations Day, and we have a quick video to just give you an orientation to the importance of this offering.
Did you know when you donate to the Human Relations Day offering, you support community developer programs, United Methodist voluntary programs, and youth offender rehabilitation programs? We are called to make an impact in communities where our brothers and sisters in Christ lack the resources or tools to reach their God-given potentials. Our gifts are part of building beloved community through faith-based volunteer programs, community developers, and programs that support youth development. Donations help create programs that seek to be in relationship with community groups and organizations to address unjust political, social, and economic systems. On Human Relations Day, we join United Methodists around the world in remembering that the size of the table of divine love is unlimited. Help us strengthen and build beloved communities. Through our gifts, may we catch a glimpse of the spirit of beloved community lived out in the lives of our brothers and sisters in Christ. Give in person, by mail, or online at umc.org/ssgive.
Write a check and send it to the church and just put in the memo section, Human Relations Sunday. Thank you. Also, there are celebrations of the life and ministry and work of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., both in Watertown and Belmont, tomorrow morning. We continue to pray every Wednesday from 7 to 7:30 in the book club. Sunday, January 23rd at 7:30 p.m. Next time I'll be online for coffee and conversation will be January 27th from 10 to 11. And we continue to collect food items for our pantries. The next collection is February 2nd. Now may God's abundant love and blessings of refuge be with you this morning and always. And may you go into the world to be living signs of God's table, extension of love, God's people. Go in peace. Amen.